Hey, good morning. You got to do better than that. Good morning. Did you guys yell on Facebook Live too? Good morning. Hey. No. No. Michelle's back there. We're perfectly fine. Thanks for asking, though. No, it's this one over here. Hey, welcome. Great to have you guys with us this morning. It's exciting to be here. Excited to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? Yeah. Excited to be here. Hey, our call to worship this morning comes out of Psalms 81. I want to read this to you. Listen to what it says here. Sing for joy to God, our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Begin the music. Strike the timbrel. Play the melodious harp and lyre. Sound the ram's horn in the new moon. At the new moon, when the moon is full, of the day of our festival. Did you know that on Sundays during the Lenten season is a day of festivals? Did you know that? That's why there's 40 days. Actually, there's 46 days, but there's 6 Sundays where you're supposed to be able to just celebrate and do whatever you want to do. Eat whatever you want to eat. Right? Yes. Yes. But I talked to Angie, and she said she's giving up candy. She's like, oh, I can't do it because I'll just go right back eating candy. Like, so anyways, it's a day of festivals. This is a decree of Israel, an ordinance of the God of Jacob. When God went out against Egypt, he established it as a statute for Joseph. I heard the unknown voice say, I removed the burden from their shoulders. Their hands were set free from the basket. In your distress, you call, and I rescued you. I answered you out of thunder clouds, and I tested you at the waters of Meribah. We're here to worship, aren't we, this morning? We're here to praise the Lord. Aren't you excited about what God's going to do this morning? I know I am. Stand with us this morning, would you? Please, Father God, we love you, Jesus. We praise your holy name. Father, we're here. The worship team is activated, Father, so to speak. We pray this morning for the Spirit of the living God to fall fresh on us this morning. A new anointing, Lord. A new anointing. So come, Father, now. Bless us, we pray. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Yeah.
Aren't you glad you have victory in Jesus? Praise the Lord. You may be seated. It's that great time in the morning where we're going to give our tithes and offerings. What a blessing it is to give back to God, isn't it? It's a great opportunity for us just to show God how much we love Him. And how obedient we are to His Word in giving. You can give online at dunkirknazarene.org. You can pop on, our Facebook page even has a spot there where you can give. Or, of course, we have the box up here where you can just come up and drop it in while they play the next song. But, you know, it's important for us to understand that God loves a cheerful giver. And He will bless you. It may not be financially. It might be some other way. I've heard testimony after testimony how God has blessed those that are just givers, you know. He just bless us. So let's pray. You guys can walk up, drop it in. If you got your phones, just get your little thing there, you know, punch your little buttons and drop it in there. God will bless your heart by giving. Father, we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for blessing us the way that you do. Father, we're so blessed. We're beyond measure, actually. Lord, bless those who give, and those who can't give, Lord, bless them too. Father, we know that there are situations, Lord, that people are in right now, that they just can't afford to give, but those that can, maybe we can give a little more, just to cover up for what others can't give. Bless those that give, Father. Bless those that can't. Bless us today. We love you, and it's in your name we pray. have to go up there. You have to have a mic. And I got my...
Your offering?
That's not my offering. That's my
alabaster. Okay. Those of you who are new and maybe not know what alabaster is...
It's noisy is what alabaster is.
Can you give me a minute?
Can I help you?
No.
Go ahead and keep talking. You're fine. Oh, they pay attention to me rather than you?
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. Those of you, after World War II ended, now, my class thinks I was here when it ended, but I wasn't. But back in the late 40s, after the war was over, the church took during the war, our church, the Nazarene church, took some hits from, you know, people didn't have money. They were living on whatever they could get by. But back in 1949, and I hear that's a great year. I don't know. My parents told me it was probably one of the best years they ever had.
It might be the best year for butter. I don't know.
But I don't know. Now, I'm just taking hearsay, because I don't really know. But some lady named Elizabeth Vinken come up after she left the convention. She, on the way back, riding a bus, the Lord said, "You can do something about this." She said, "Lord, how can I do something?" But she began to think about the lady who come in and poured her alabaster, her perfume in the alabaster jar on Jesus' feet. So the Lord inspired her to start alabaster. So she called all the ladies, I suppose they had phones back then, but she asked them to give up one bottle of perfume. I guess perfume was expensive. I never wore it, but our mom wore something called, was it Charlie? And mom always, when I'd get in trouble, which was about every Sunday, but if I had to use her hanky, it always smelled like Charlie. And whenever I hear smell a whiff of that, it reminds me of my mom, because she and I don't remember if it was expensive or not. But anyway, so she sent out a message, "Ladies, if you just give up one bottle of perfume, if you'll do that and give it to that." Well, that's how alabaster started. So it's been going since 1949. But the thing that was most interesting to me was that here's one lady who was on a train or a bus, I can't remember, and God gave her a vision of how we could do that. And I want you to know here and online, 100% of what's put in this jug, and any jug, goes to buildings, buying land, but all over the world that goes. So if you do that, we appreciate it so much. And then I have to tell Kenny and Angie, I was short two crisis care kits, and I've just enjoyed you guys helping so much. But I didn't know it, but Wednesday night, and I got four more in, and had enough to get that. So now, instead of having 36, we got 42. And all the years I've done it, we've never had over 36. They may have in the past, but since I've been doing it. So thank you so much for your offering and your love. And every time I go in the store, when I got this long stuff, I tell them what we're doing. And so it's been a blessing to me to share. And it was all because you guys gave and helped. And so don't forget alabaster. It's a great thing. And I don't know if you can maybe give up a jar of aftershave, but don't give up deodorant. No.
Hey, Cheryl, I'm going to ask you to stay up here.
I got to get my box.
You can get your box. I am dumping you. Oh, I don't have to.
What do you want me to stay here for?
Because we're going to pray for missions today. Oh, okay. This is our last Sunday. Well, the whole month of November, of February, this is February, right? We've been, it's all been missions month. And we've been just celebrating missions. And we're going into our prayer time right now. And of course, we're dumping all this stuff in there and making all kinds of good noise. And so we're going to pray for missions. And if you guys have a prayer request, as the worship team plays, you always want to come to the altar and pray, you're welcome to do that. And I think it's important for us to understand that missions is a huge part of what the Nazarene Church does. We reach out beyond our four walls, or six walls, or how many walls we have in here. And we reach out beyond those things, those walls, and touch the lives of others who are less fortunate than us. Through our crisis care kits, right? Through our alabaster offering, through our Wednesday night offering. And by the way, I want to let you know, I got some announcements for you real quick. Starting Wednesday night, I mean, if you don't come on Wednesday nights, okay, but you might want to start. We're going to be doing a Bible study called Jesus and Me, written by, Jesus in Me, written by Ann Graham. That starts this Wednesday So if you don't come to Wednesday night church, you think maybe I should start coming because it's going to be pretty awesome, these things. So this, yeah, it's about the Holy Spirit through the Advent, the Lenten season, I guess I should say. It's about all that. So we're going to pray for missions. We're going to have Cheryl stay up here. But as the song plays, Cheryl, you might want to just sit down in the front pew because we're going to sing this next song. So stand with us, would you? We're going to sing this song. The altar is open if you want to come up and pray. The altar is open this morning.
To die, poured out for.
asking God to continue to bless our missionaries wherever they're at. And I don't know if you've heard the story, but Jocelyn, Gail and Margaret's granddaughter, was in a really rough accident and like thrown 50, 60 feet into a cornfield, rolled her car. And God completely protected her. Praise His name. And we're also going to be praying for Jody this morning because she's got some things going on too. But this is, everyone gather around Cheryl, let's lay hands. Let's pray for our missionaries. Pray for missions. Let's do that this morning. I don't know about you, but I love missions. I do. I think missions are the greatest things ever. Missionaries are great people. Let's just pray. Father, this morning we just want to thank You for this day. Father, You are awesome. You are amazing. You are great. Father, thank You for working through this pandemic. Father, bringing us to a point to where people feel more comfortable being in church. It's great. But only by Your moving of Your Spirit that has happened. And Lord, this morning I want to pray for Jody. Father God, our sweet Jody in Pennsylvania, Father. She's just really had that surgery and she's not doing it. She's struggling to get well. Touch her, Jesus. Thank You for Jocelyn, Lord, the blessing that You bestowed upon her, Father God. This is one of our kids, one of our girls. She may not come to this church, Lord, but she's one of ours. We love her. So thank You, Father God, for watching over her, sending Your angels to her, Lord. And Father, this morning, we want to pray for missions. Our missionaries, Father God, overseas or even here in the United States. Father, we love missions and You love missions, Father. You sent out missionaries. And Father, this is just a chance, Father, this morning that we get to just pray for them this morning. Thank You, Father God, for the blessings that our missionaries are. Continue to work in their lives. Continue to work through Sister Laura High as she leads our missions department here in the Northeast Indiana District. Bless her, Lord. Father God, thank You for Sister Cheryl, who so faithfully has dedicated herself to continue to bring in us information about missions and working as our president here in our Dunkirk, Indiana. Father, she's a joy. She's a blessing. Continue to use her, Lord Jesus, to fulfill her mission and purpose in serving You, Father. We love You, Jesus, today. Thank You for loving us. And it's in Your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Kids, you're dismissed for Children's Church. What a great day to be a follower of Jesus. Amen. What a great day to just be a follower of Christ. Stand up and say it, girl. Amen. I'm sure they feel the same about you, Angie. We love you. And praise the Lord, You're with us. So we're glad, grateful for that. Anybody else have a testimony they want to share?
Hey, I think we even went to our local missions that we were last Sunday. That was so much fun, and we just were able to feed the people.
Yes.
And we took extra to the fire department that was left over. I mean, I think it's important to give our local,
our food pantry is a big mission field. It may not, people don't may not think of it that way, but our food pantry, that's missions work, isn't it, Judy? It's missions work. And so, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes. You guys are just a bunch of missionaries. Just a bunch of missionaries. Praise the Lord. It's awesome. It is awesome. Hey, I'm excited this morning to preach this message. Well, what happened just now? Anyways, did you speak, Jason? Nice. Hey, for those of you on Facebook, welcome again. We love you. We pray that this message will hit your heart. We're talking about Nick at night. Nicodemus. Nicodemus. Who knows anything about Nicodemus? You all know about Nicodemus, don't you? Nick at night. After you're gone, what's one thing that you think you'll be remembered for? What legacy have you left? What legacy have you left? The old. You remember that Tom Fett when he did. This is what he was remembered for. You remember that guy? He was. You don't have to fill in that last part, because some of it might not be good. So don't fill that in. Nicodemus is mentioned in the Gospel of John 3 different times. And each time the comment is the same. I would have chose his tagline. You remember that Nicodemus, he was the one that went to Jesus at night, right? He went to Jesus at night. He was a Pharisee, which was a religious leader. So, for him to go to Jesus, for him to even participate, anything that was going on with Jesus was wrong, right? Was not supposed to happen, because the Pharisees were the ones that crucified Christ, weren't they? Right? They were the ones, the religious leaders, that were against him. Sometimes it's difficult to erase your lifeline, isn't it? That tag that's put on your life. Sometimes it's difficult to get rid of that. Because you're always... Brothers and sisters, let me just say this to you, okay? You will always be remembered for something, right? You'll always be remembered for something. Angie, you played right into my hand this morning, given the testimony of who some of these people in our church are. Because you'll be remembered for something. You remember when that person taught that Sunday school class? They were my Sunday school teacher. They were my Sunday school teacher. That guy was my pastor. And you might not even be referring to me. You might be referring to Reverend Apsher or somebody like that. That guy was my pastor. That was a legacy that was left by that individual. So the question is this morning, folks, what legacy are you leaving? What legacy are you leaving? Right? What legacy are you leaving? Jerry just buried his mother of 90 years this last week. And you talk to some of the people and you hear about this godly woman who was a tremendous saint who served the church and served people. And what a legacy to leave, huh, Jerry? What a legacy. And what that legacy does is it passes on from generation to generation to generation. Now other people see what you've done and who you are and what you've been, and they say, you know what? I want to be like you fill in the blank. The legacy. But sometimes we have a legacy that people don't really want to follow, don't we? Maybe we've had something in our past that we're having a hard time getting over, getting past, getting through, right? Maybe you're known for something other than being this great, great Christian and great follower of Christ. And when people like that come to church, the first thing that we are is skeptical, aren't we? We get skeptical of who they are because of their past, their legacy, right? So Nick's got this thing. Oh, Nick, he went to Jesus at night. He wasn't really, he kind of hit himself a little bit. See, sometimes the defining moments of your life is the first impression, a failure, a fluke, or a flaw. And sometimes the tagline you get stuck with is unfair. However, if folks look deeper, they often discover that taglines are fickle and they're incomplete, aren't they? They're fickle and they're incomplete. As we look at Nicodemus, we'll discover his real tagline. We don't know exactly why he came to Jesus at night. Perhaps he had a day job where he worked during the day, and the only time he had to go to Jesus was at night. Maybe that was the case. Maybe that was it. Some of you work during the day, and you know how hard it is sometimes. You get done with work, you go home, you feed yourself or your husband or your wife, and you do all that. Those of you that the husband that cook, good job. But those of you that don't cook, good job. I mean, did I say that out loud? I was thinking it. Anyways, and maybe you're just exhausted. So Nicodemus may have went home after work, and he said, I'm just going to put my feet up for a minute. Maybe he fell asleep in his recliner, right, in his lazy boy. I have to go meet with Jesus. That's right, I got to. So he went at night. Maybe that was the case. I don't know. Did they have lazy boys back then? Probably not. Maybe lazy boyths. I don't know. Anyways, we don't really know why. However, we know that he did go at night, don't we? Got your Bibles open to John chapter 3. Start with verse 1, going all the way through to verse 17. It says, now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. They came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher. You are a teacher who has come from God. For no one can perform the signs you are doing if God were not with you. Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. And Nicodemus says, how can someone be born again when they're old? Nicodemus says, surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. And Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and of spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit gives birth to spirit. Amen? Whew! That's Pastor Tom going to say tonight, this morning. So you should not be surprised at my sayings. You must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell when it comes from where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. And Nicodemus says, how could this be? You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you don't understand these things? Jesus is actually asking him a question. You are a teacher, and you don't get this? You don't understand this? Very truly I tell you, we speak what we know, and we testify what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you don't believe. How will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses must be lifted up, the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. Father, I pray for the word, your word, Lord, that would penetrate our hearts and our minds. Help us to see, Father God, what you want us to see and understand what you want us to understand. Teach us this morning, Lord. We love you. Amen. Again, we don't know why Nicodemus went at night. We have no idea why. However, folks, most folks believe that was because Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He had to protect himself and his reputation, right? He was a Pharisee, so he had to protect himself. If the other Pharisees find out that he went to Jesus, there's trouble in the house of Pharisee, right? There's trouble. So he had to protect himself and his reputation. You see, Jesus is seen to be a rabbi, a rabble-rouser, a real problem for the Pharisees. Did you know that? Jesus was a real problem for the Pharisees. Let me ask you something this morning. Are you a problem for Satan? Are you a problem for the Pharisees? When you go somewhere, when you're talking one-on-one with somebody, does Satan go, just leave my people alone? You're trouble for me. Are you trouble for him? I hope you are. See, Jesus was trouble for the Pharisees. He was trouble. He spoke as one who had authority and power. He spoke as one who had authority and power, which was quite unlike how the scribes and the Pharisees taught. See, Jesus didn't say, "Well, I think this is what my Father wants me to say." No. Jesus taught with authority, and he taught with power, and he taught with boldness. So that's what scared the Pharisees about him. There was no question about who he was. No question about who he was. So he started talking. Can you just imagine the Pharisees just shaking in their boots? Because Jesus is on the scene, and Nicodemus has recognized him. Not only has he recognized him, but he also recognizes him for who he is. Because remember, at the beginning of the scripture, it says, "Surely you have come from God." Because nobody else can do the things that you've done unless God is with him. Right? So Nicodemus recognizes who he is. He recognizes him. The people were beginning to follow Jesus rather than the Pharisees. So now Jesus has this following behind him, and all these people are following him. And the Pharisees are going, "Wait a minute. What's happening? Our people are leaving us and following Jesus. What is going on?" This is what started things stirring up. This is what started the trouble. This is what started things moving. Because the Pharisees were very scared about what Jesus' potential was. Nicodemus knew that he would be endangering his livelihood and his very life by believing in Jesus. So fearfully and timidly, under the cover of darkness, he makes his way to Jesus. He makes his way to Jesus. We always said to our kids, nothing good happens after midnight. We always told our kids that. Anybody else tell your kids that? Nothing good ever happens after midnight. So, at 10 o'clock, you need to be home. We gave until 10:30, I think. But, you know what I mean? Nothing good happens after midnight. So, Nicodemus is going at dark, at nighttime, to meet with Jesus. He's going to the cover of darkness. This encounter changed the course of his life. This encounter changed the course of Nicodemus' life. Things are starting to change in him. He's recognizing Jesus. He is intrigued by him. He's drawn to him. He's wanting to understand who he really is. You get it? He's starting to buy in to what Jesus is teaching. And all this is happening, and his life is changing. He's going to change the course of his life. Jesus informed Nicodemus that if he truly wants to see the kingdom of God, he has to be born again. And brothers and sisters, if you want to see the kingdom of God, guess what? You have to be born again. Sold out to Jesus. Whew. That's good preaching, Pastor Tom. It was good. Anyways, he had to be born physically, but now he has to be born by the Spirit. He has to be born. Nicodemus had never heard such talk. And Jesus taught like no other one has ever heard before. His words became both frightening and liberating. Jesus' words both became frightening and liberating. Frightening because if he buys into what Jesus is teaching, the Pharisees are not going to be happy. Right? It could end his life. It's like being part of a gang and all of a sudden you don't want to be part of that gang anymore. What does the gang members do? They hunt you down and they try to kill you because of what you know. And see, Nicodemus knew a lot. He was a religious leader. And if he joins Jesus' camp, trouble's brewing. You see, Jesus explained that love brought him to the world to give eternal life to all who believe in him. Love brought him here. Love brought Jesus here. Ain't that great? It wasn't anything else but love. His father said, "Jesus, you gotta go. My people are a mess. I love them. They need a Savior bad. Explain that love brought him to the world, to us. Eternal life for all who believe. He didn't come to condemn the world, but to save it. See, a lot of people look at Jesus as somebody who's came down, and I think Jesus gets a bum rap. I'm going to be careful how I say this, Greg, right? I think Jesus gets a bum rap because of us. That makes sense? He gets a bum rap because of us, because we're judgmental. So everybody thinks that Jesus must be judgmental. You're a follower of Christ, and if you take on the personality and the characteristics of Christ, so that means you're like him and he's like you, so there's not a separation there. That makes sense? Stop being like that, okay? Stop being like that. Love covers over a multitude of sin, doesn't it? All those people that have those bad raps back in the day, like we talked about earlier, you know, all those bad reputation, all that stuff going on that used to go on in their lives that we continue to hold over their heads, because there's no way you can change from that, right? Right? Jesus can deliver you from anything. He can deliver you from anything. Enough about that. Nicodemus must have been shocked. He was not just an ordinary Pharisee. He was a ruler and a member of the Sanhedrin. Basically, the Supreme Court of today's world is who Nicodemus was. He was part of the world leaders, the Sanhedrin. He sat on the court. He'd been convinced that keeping the rules of the Pharisees would save a man. He had made a living condemning those who didn't keep the rules. And now he hears from Jesus that love and faith brings eternal life. He's confused, isn't he? Wouldn't you be confused? All your life you've followed these rules. All your life you've bought in to the idea that if you just follow the rules, you'll be good. And Jesus steps into the picture. And he says, no. Love changes everything. It's love. The greatest darkness that Nicodemus experienced was not the darkness of that particular night, but the darkness of Phariseeism. The darkness of Phariseeism. Now this new teacher is telling Nicodemus that his judgmentalism is and rule-keeping, the orientation of his life, is worthless. He doesn't need to live under law. He needs love. He doesn't need to live under... You know what, folks? Don't you think we all just need to be loved? We just all need to be loved. We all just need to have love in our lives. You want to see somebody miserable? You see somebody miserable because they have no love in their life. They're broken. People need love. Nicodemus needed love, didn't he? All the laws that the Pharisees followed, all the laws that the Sanhedrin put in place, all these laws were not going to do for him what he needed. It's not going to do what he needed until love entered the picture. He was lost. I'm going to stop here for just a minute and tell you, if you don't have love in your life, I love you. Facebook friends, if you're struggling with that, I love you. Pray for you every day. And if you were here, I'd give you a big old hug. Because that's what the world's missing, isn't it? Is hugs. Hugs. Our world has gone crazy, folks. You know that? Read the other day that Mr. Potato Head is a problem. Did you read about that? Mr. Potato Head's a problem. The Muppets are a problem. People are offended by puppets. They're offended by puppets. What the world needs now is just more love. They need more love. Dr. Seuss. Tyler was mentioning about Dr. Seuss being a bad guy. I guess green eggs and ham. I don't know. I'm not going to eat green eggs and ham. My guess is this means they're probably spoiled or bad or something. I don't know. We live in a world that's gone crazy, folks. But I still believe that people just need love. That's what the problem is. You know, the old country song, looking for love in all the wrong places, right? Looking for love in all the wrong places. I think that's what's happening in our world today. They're looking for love in all the wrong places. I remember looking for love and finding Jesus. And finding Jesus and Him being enough. And Him being enough for me. I fell in love with my Father. Suddenly the man who came at night is awakened to a new light. And Nicodemus steps into the new dawn and a brand new journey. You see, Nicodemus' journey is a lot like our journey, isn't it? It's a lot like our journey. The assumption is that he was born again that night. Some would tell us that at the point Nicodemus was in, he was saved and nothing could do or not do could change his eternal destiny. We Nazarenes believe a little bit differently, though, don't we? We understand that human nature, we have human nature and we have free will. We know there are important moments in a person's life. There are steps forward, right? The little saying is one step forward and two steps back, right? Have anybody else's life ever been like that? Where you take 1 foot step forward, it's like, well, here we go again, right? Progress seems to be delayed in a big way. But we're on a journey. We're on a journey. And a lot of people in our instantaneous lives, we want things to be instant. We want everything to be right now. Have it your way at Burger King, right? We want it right now. We want things to happen immediately. And guess what? That's not what we are. That's not who we are. There are times there's a delayed reaction in our lives. Because we just don't understand everything that we're supposed to understand. And all of a sudden, the light starts brightening a little bit more and a little bit more. This is what's happened to Nicodemus, right? The light's shining a little brighter and a little brighter, and he's getting it more, and he's like, okay, all right, I get this. I get this now. The next time we see Nicodemus, he was about 2.5 years later in John 7, 44 through 53. A group of Pharisees are talking and the question is asked. He's with his people. He's with the Pharisee and the question is asked. Have any of the Pharisees believed in Jesus? And here Nicodemus is sitting among the people and he's like, whoa. Wait a minute. I didn't think that question was going to come up. And Nicodemus dodges the question and half-heartedly defends Jesus by saying that a person should be able to state his case before judgment is passed on him. And the Pharisees ask him if he's connected to this man from Galilee. And Nicodemus keeps his mouth closed. He doesn't say a word. Here we see that the man who came to Jesus at night continues trapped in darkness. When you don't speak up, are you embarrassed by Jesus? Are you struggling with your own relationship with Christ? What's going on with Nicodemus? What's going on? Let me go back here. He was afraid. He was afraid to stand up for Christ. He was afraid. Now, I'm not saying you got to go stand on the corner and pull out your Bible and start reading Scripture at the top of your lungs. I'm not saying you have to do that. But if you do, I'll stand behind you. I might even stand in front of you. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God and salvation for everyone. First for the Jews, then for the Gentiles, right? I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Here Nicodemus is saying nothing. He's quiet. He's sitting in the witness stand, and a question's asked, and he's not saying a word. He's not saying a word. It's difficult for us to be overly hard on Nicodemus because each of us has been in a situation like this, haven't we? You ever find yourself in a situation like that? Where it's an opportunity for you to confess and profess Christ and you say nothing? Even those of us that talk too much sometimes have a hard time professing Christ. What are they going to think of me? Are they going to think I'm crazy? How do you follow somebody you can't see? Courage drained from our bodies and we stood pale and impotent. Frances Havel, she was a writer, wrote about going into a boarding school. Soon after she became a Christian, she found that she was the only Christian in school for 100 girls, and she was afraid to confess Christ. But then she came to the realization that she was the only one that he had around those 100 girls. She was it. She was that missionary that was sent to that school, that boarding school. At first she was afraid to confess Christ before all these companions. Then this thought came to her, I am the only one Jesus has here. Are you the only one that Jesus has at your work, your school? Are you the only one that Jesus has in your home, maybe even? Are you it? Now his darkness is fear. His darkness is fear. But don't remain in the shadow of fear. Be bold. Speak up for your Jesus. Remember, courage is not the absence of fear, but courage is acting in spite of your fear. That's what courage is acting in spite of your fear. Stand up and be counted. Stand up and be counted. Right? God continues to work in Nicodemus' life. He's growing in grace. 6 months later, we see him again, but this is different. He has decided to take a stand in John 19, 38 through 42. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, what do? They go and they tend to Jesus' body after he's taken off the cross. Joseph obviously has the tomb, right? But they tend to him. It's interesting that not one of the original 12 disciples claimed Jesus' body. Not one of them did. None of them did. But Joseph and Nicodemus did. A rich man and one of the ruling Pharisees were the courageous ones. Verse 39 says that Nicodemus bought 100 pounds of myrrh and aloe to wrap up the body of Jesus. It seems that he has reached a new level of spiritual maturity, doesn't it? He has finally left the shadow of the night. He's finally put the darkness behind him. And he's pressing towards the light. There's become a total consecration of his life to the point where he's saying, go ahead, kill me if you wish. Do it. Go ahead and kick me out of the Sanhedrin and the club of the Phariseeisms if you want to. None of this is important to me. Church, let me tell you what's happening in our world today. And some of you already know. There's a bill that's been passed in the House There's a bill that's going to the Senate this week. It's called the Equality Act, right? And it could shut me down and what I'm preaching. Did you know that? It could. But you know what? It's not going to. It's not going to. As I told the worship team this morning in prayer, the prayer room, Paul preached in prison. We have to have courage and boldness to stand up for what we believe in, to stand up for our God. Amen. And when we don't, when we are afraid because of what could possibly happen to us, folks, that's when we've lost our voice. I will stand up and I will be counted. Nothing changes in this pulpit. I will preach the truth. The truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Sin is still sin. Amen? Yeah. Sin is still sin. This Jesus you have killed has given me real life. He is the Son of God that will proudly be numbered with His followers. Is that you this morning? I'll proudly be numbered with His followers. He has given me real life. I knew what life was before Christ came into my life. Did you believe that? I mean, I was kind of wavering and floating. I didn't know what I was doing. Christ gives my life focus. Right? And I will proudly be numbered with His followers. Proudly be numbered. I wish we could change Nicodemus' tagline, don't you? The important thing about his life is not that he came to Jesus at night. It's that he came. He showed up. He came to Jesus. He came to Jesus and was born again. Why am I stuck? He grew as a Christian through disappointment and missteps. Haven't you done the same thing? You've grown into a Christian through all your disappointments? How about your missteps? Anybody have any missteps in your life? Anyone have one this week? Don't raise your hand. Right? We continue the process, don't we? Continue growing and growing and growing closer to God and growing closer to God. And eventually our heavenly reward is that mansion that we sang about this morning, right? In the song Victory in Jesus. He stepped out of the shadows of the Phariseeism and fear to stand with Jesus. In the end, it wasn't about Nicodemus coming to Jesus during the night. It's about Nicodemus coming to Jesus during his night, his darkness, in the midst of his night, in the blackness of his own heart. He came to Jesus. In the dark night of the tomb, it was Nicodemus who came to Jesus and tended to him. Here's our challenge this morning, folks. Friends, what about you? Have you taken a stand? This beautiful noonday sunshine of complete commitment awaits you, and Jesus will be blessed by it. Be blessed by your coming. He'll be blessed by it. I don't know what's going on in your life, folks. I don't know if you're following Christ, if you're struggling. Maybe some of you are really struggling in your walk. I don't know. Having a hard time. Maybe you're at night. Maybe you're having a dark, dark moment. Come to Jesus this morning. Come to Jesus. Worship team, come back up. So worship team sings this, leads us in this song this morning. As the worship team leads us in this song this morning, the altars are open. It's the Lenten season. What better time to get things squared away with you and God? What better time Maybe you've been a Christian from all of your life. Maybe you've followed him and you just had, you know, you just want to say, Pastor, I've just had a rough time the last couple of months, last year, last 2 years, whatever. He loves you. And he's ready for you to come back home this morning. So stand with us this morning, would you? Again, the altar is open. You come this morning.
Before him.
just need you, Lord. That struggle, Father God, in their walk. And Father, just like Nicodemus. Just like Nicodemus, Father God, maybe it's just they're scared, Father, to step out and be counted, to stand up and be counted, Father. Work through their lives, Jesus. Touch them, Lord. Father, we love you so much this morning. Thank you for this season, Father, that we're in, this Lenten season, where we come together, Father God, to celebrate who you are in our lives and what you want to do through us, Lord. Help us, Father, to be all that we can be for you, Jesus. We love you. Dismiss us now with your love, your grace, your mercy, with your power, Lord, and your authority. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.